It comes to us from Austin Oasis, which is one of our many growing Oasis communities around the country. I was up there a while back, and I got to hear him give the main talk when I was visiting Austin Oasis. And I thought, this is really thought-provoking, and I think our gang would like to hear it too. And so we thank him for making the trip down here. Just a little quick background. Andrew Escher lives in Austin, Texas, and started the effective Altruism group in the city. He's got a healthy obsession with finance, entrepreneurship, and futurism outside of his daytime work at Celebrant and Media Tech Ventures. So let's thank him for being here and for making the trek all the way down from Austin to speak with us today. Andrew Escher.
So you go from, you basically gained $40,000 by just putting $20 away a month. And that's what's really powerful here. So one of the things we're going to talk about is these aren't big changes. They're small changes, but if you make them consistently, they really add up over time. And a lot of people, this is a common example, but a lot of people don't take into account how much that cup of Starbucks is actually costing them. $20 a month is four coffees a month at Starbucks. And four is just pretty darn good. Okay, so how much per month would you have to save that $900,000 at the end? This is aiming on the early side, probably the latest is like, you know, 35 years old, but the same concepts will apply throughout. If you have 40 years to go and you want to have $900,000 in your bank account at the end, you just need to save $363 a month. That's it, $900,000 right there. To do it 35 years, now you've come way up. I mean, it's amazing what a few years difference makes. Now you've got to do $523 a month, but definitely still doable. And if you've only got 30 years, then you've got to do $766 per month. So that's kind of what we're aiming for. Look at your timeline and your horizon. It kind of keeps going up and up. But if we can save you about $766 a month for the next 30 years, that would be worth about $900,000 to you. It's a lot of money, and that's a lot of peace of mind. One thing that I want you to notice again is starting today is really important. The total investment here for that 40 years is $50,000 less than 35 years. And it's $100,000 less than 30 years. So waiting 10 years, you know, waiting from the age of 30 to 40 to start saving, costs you $100,000, which means like, kind of take it seriously. If you think that what I'm saying makes sense, take it seriously and start today, tomorrow. Do not start 2 years down the line. It will cost you thousands of dollars. General equation. If you say, how many years will it take me to double my money? You can say 72 divided by your return on investment. So just taking this back into account, it basically you say, well, 7% a year isn't reasonable. You can say, I can only get 4% or I want to do safe investments. This is how long it takes you to double your money. So the average stock market return is 12%, 7 to 12%. If you're on the high end of that, 6 years to double your money. If you invest $100 today, in 6 years you'll have $200. In 12 years, you'll have $400. In 18 years, you'll have $800. So that's how it kind of goes, and that's the power of compounding. One other concern to note is, this is kind of your savings, just a general rubric for your 10-year savings based on making decisions. So if you can eliminate a monthly expense for like $1, that's worth $171 at the end of 10 years. So every dollar that you save today, or monthly, the next 10 years is worth $171 at the end of that. It's meaningful, and I think that's a really good way to think of your habits and your spending habits when you're looking to save, you know, $5-$10 off your cell phone. If it's a yearly expense, it's 14 times. So $100 a year is worth $1,400 over 10. The lesson is start down and compound. Let this get on your side, don't let it work against you. Debt works the opposite way. That's very common. It's not a bad thing to be in debt. It can be useful. But debt is working against you in the opposite way. So if you are in debt, it's very important to take that seriously because these benefits work in the bank's favor, not in your favor. Okay, so here's the three keys that I want to talk about. And I want to start with, my last name is Escher, and I want to start with this painting by Escher. So this is a lithograph, which means that it's a piece of metal that's carved out to make this look like that. It's a beautiful painting, right? Has everyone seen that before? Like all the visual effects? That was done in metal. That's metal. It's carved out. It's called a lithograph. The thing that makes that beautiful is its limitations. It's not that you can actually build a waterfall like that. It's that he can give you this perception of something that is like grandiose, amazing, changes how you look at it based on a limited form, a very limited art form. And I want to look at some things in our life. Taking things away from life, simplifying, can be its own form of art. So don't think of it as like, oh, I have to cut back, or I'm starving myself or doing things on that kind of thing. But actually say, like, I want to design my life as art. I want to focus my attention attention and my efforts where I can, and I want to paint a beautiful lithograph. Okay, so place. Is your home the best place to do everything at? This is my first question. I grew up in the Midwest, Kansas City, Missouri, a little suburb up there, in a house that had two guest rooms, because we only had two siblings, and so we had four bedrooms, five bedrooms, two guest rooms that were always empty, and a basement that was just gigantic and completely unused, and just tons of space. And we literally used it 40 times in the 13 years I lived in this house. So what we had to do with that was basically people had to drive farther out to my house because it was farther out on top in the suburbs. And my house, we had to furnish it with all of the stuff that like a bar would typically have, a pool table, we had to get televisions, we had to get all this stuff just to entertain people 40 times. All the art on the walls was used 40 times to entertain other people. What's crazy about that is that it's really inefficient. There are tons of places out there right down the road where you can meet people and hang out. So maybe your house isn't the best place to have people over. Maybe it is. Make that decision though and choose that and know that there's a cost to that. When you make a decision to have like a guest room or an atrium in your house, and you say this will be nice for when people come over, understand that that's going to cost you even when people don't come over. And that there are plenty of places in our society that can go for gathering. Another thing I wanted to say is kind of that like libraries, places like this where there are quiet study times, there are co-working spaces, there's a lot of places to get work done. I know that a lot of people like their space and they like having their space. There are places in the world to get your quiet time and your space that don't involve spending extra for a house. Why that is important is because the number one determining factor in the cost of your house is the number of square feet. And this is something that, as time has gone on, the American family has gotten on average smaller, and the average American household has gotten way bigger, like 300% growth in the last 100 years in the average size of the house, while the family size has gone down. I don't know why we need this much space. Do we hate each other that much? What's crazy about this is a lot of people are like, I need to move out farther. Like, houses are so expensive, I need to move out farther because I can't afford the house the size I want. But really what ends up happening is, this is in a metropolitan area. So this is the price in a metropolitan area. If you go outside of a metropolitan area and you try to escape it, you're down at $81 per foot. It's 4% difference. It's almost negligible. 4% size of the house difference between being way out in the middle of nowhere and being in a metropolitan area. So really escaping the city doesn't do a lot for you to cut costs. Cutting your square footage really does. And 4.1% difference in between MSA and out of MSA, so kind of in the Houston area or farther outside. It's really important to realize this. The number one factor in the cost of your house is the size of your house. If you can deal with less of a house, that's the largest expense for most people. If you can make it work and you can find other places, you're going to save hundreds of thousands of dollars over your lifetime. This is just to kind of rub it in the faces of the people in the Northeast that their houses cost a lot more. You'll notice that we're kind of considered the South here, the Midwest or the South, and we have some of the lowest price per square feet here. That said, it's still the number one determining factor in the price of your house. So ask yourself the question, when you're moving, if you live in an apartment currently, if you're in a house, how can your home best fit your goals? Is it the best place for me to socialize? Is it the best place for me to read? Is it the best place for me to work out? Home gyms are square footage, they cost a lot of money. It may be worth getting that gym subscription. It may even pay for your personal trainer. Another thing to keep in mind is that the cost of the home itself on that mortgage is not the final cost of a home. You've got electricity, heat, water, maintenance, your television, your homeowners association fees, gas, and almost all of them increase directly with the size of your house. So by choosing a large house, again, not everyone who's moved, but when you move, keep this in mind. These costs come in and scale directly with the size of your house. In Houston, your summer AC cost is a lot larger if you have a 3,000 square foot house than if you have a 1,000 square foot house. Okay, so that is housing. Housing is a major expense. It's where most people spend most of their money. You spend a lot of time there. Most of the time spent in your house is sleeping, invested in a very nice mattress. Totally worth it. very careful with the square footage of your house. The second thing I want to talk about is transit costs. America is absolutely insane when it comes to driving, and Houston's even worse than Austin in this regard, which I can't stand Austin. So, but there are ways to avoid transit costs. I want to start with the bad news. This is the average annual cost to own and operate a vehicle in the United States in 2016. So it's actually down a percentage point from 2015. It'll probably be going up this year, especially with the gas prices increases. That's the average annual cost to own and operate a vehicle in the United States. The average household income in the United States is $50,000, and the average household has two cars. $16,000 a year for an average household is going to cars. Very expensive. If you can cut that down, cut your driving costs down, there's significant savings to be had. What are your alternatives? I'm not sure how bike-friendly of a city Houston is. Austin's fairly bike-friendly. Houston probably has areas that are bike-friendly. Most cities have like some pockets, and if you really design where your life is, you can make this work in almost any city. The cost of a bike every year is $100 to $400, and you get all of these benefits. You get endorphins, you're healthier, it's better for the environment, there's less noise pollution, cars are really loud, you get your exercise time so you don't have to go to the gym anymore, it's even better, and you get environmental adaptation. There's a guy named Mr. Money Mustache who calls that last one, environmental adaptation, he calls it badass. Right? And I think that is a cool thing. This is Denmark. You see, they're taking their kids, and it's freezing. And trust me, that's like 0 degrees Celsius over there, which is it's freezing. And they're doing this every day on ice. I don't know if I choose that or Houston, but at least this time of year, towards like February, you'll probably be okay here on a bike. So if you can switch any driving, you can bike it. The average IRS mileage reimbursement is 51 cents per mile. So the government thinks that every mile you drive costs you 51 cents. And they'll give you that benefit on your taxes. That's a lot of money. That means that a 10 mile round trip costs you $5 a day. If you must drive, buy used cars to avoid depreciation and lower your insurance costs, and buy in cash to avoid financing charges. That'll save you $4,000 a year. So buying new cars and buying in cash, buying used cars and buying in cash can save about half of that price off that $8,000. But you don't have to drive. I really want to push bike culture. I don't fully buy into this yet. I'm trying to. It is tough, I agree. But you can move your whole house out on the bike. And these things, now you've got electronic bikes, so you can turn them into basically motorcycles. It's really cool. And that costs like $600. So that's a treat to yourself and would easily take up if you can do 100, 200 miles or more of driving a year, it'll pay for itself. Okay, the final thing I want to talk about, we've got our housing costs and our transit costs, which are the two major expenses that people and families spend. The last thing I want to talk about is your defaults. Your TV and your internet, the people you hang out with, the drinks that you drink, the kombucha, the beer, the coffee, your cell phone bill, utilities, groceries, and the public library. I want to focus particularly on the public libraries. Remember that every single purchase that you have on default, that like you guys are paying for monthly charges, it's a really, really sticky situation. It ends up costing you 171 times that monthly charge. So, for instance, I have a T-Mobile bill that's $61 a month, and I know that within a couple weeks I can call it up and get like $5 off a month. And for some reason I keep putting that off. I don't know why the conversation is so terrible to me, but right now, me putting that off, if I just didn't and never did it, it would cost me over like $3,000. It's unbelievable. So we have to do stuff like that. Watch your monthly expenses like a hawk. Watch your alcohol expenses. I think a lot of us, at least me in my younger days, still younger days, would spend a lot of money on alcohol at bars. Beer at home is a lot cheaper, and you can brew your own and maybe even make it cheaper. Kombucha at home, does that cost you a lot less than buying it in store? Yeah, so James knows. $4 to $5 for that kombucha kid store. You can make it for a dollar a piece or less at home. Yeah, way less than a dollar. Yeah, the cost of sugar and tea. So that's really wonderful. If you check those defaults, you're going to see that there's a lot of gains to be had pretty quickly. I've given you this worksheet. Again, this is the link to the worksheet. In this, it has some tips on grocery shopping and on on how to change to a bike culture, on badassity, and then on cutting the electricity costs in your home. There's really a lot to be gained from things like that too, these small innovations in electricity costs. Again, every dollar a month ends up $171 a week in 10 years. And in 40 years, that's a lot more. To contextualize all of this, I want to talk about something about the hedonic treadmill. How many people have heard of the hedonic treadmill? Maybe 5-10% of the audience. Great, really, really excited to teach you about this. Basically, you are almost always going to be as happy as you are today. If something really bad happens to you, if you lose a loved one, if you don't get a job promotion that you were really wanting, if something bad happens, you will be temporarily sad, but the endorphins in your brain are generally the same. So over time, if you live in a house that is 500 square feet or 5,000 square feet, your endorphins don't change. The body in the house that you actually inhabit really doesn't change. Exercise can change your general state of happiness, and good social relations can. So the rule of this is that to know that if you have to set yourself back, or you have like these temporary setbacks, or you feel like you're constantly at the same rate of happiness, even like you're gonna build a newer house, you're gonna get a new car, and it's just gonna make you happier and happier, it can't happen, and it can't happen in the opposite way either. Like, you're not gonna get instantly happier because you get a cheaper car either. But getting newer and newer, you might as well choose the cheaper option in that case. I guess that's the point, because you should choose the cheaper option if you're never gonna be any happier because of choosing that option. Choose social relationships, choose exercise, and really redefine your wealth. Another thing that I see particularly commonly in like the millennial culture is the travel. Travel as the end all be all of wealth. And if I can be traveling, well then I have everything I want. And I think that's okay. And people can define wealth however they want, but being very careful about how we define it is important. There's physical wealth. There's having a really great body that you love being in, and you can stretch and run. There's career wealth, liking your job. It's not just being in a high position in your job, but doing and contributing to your job. There's emotional wealth. I feel good, people around me feel good. I make people feel good. There's relational wealth. I have strong relationships and we help build each other up. You can have time wealth. You can trade that. You can contribute to a certain mission. Then you can have financial wealth and you can have contributional wealth. So giving your time to Oasis here would be contributional wealth. And it would help you build your emotional and relational capital. Redefine wealth, choose what you value, be very consistent on what you value. We're all kind of, we're not mainstreamers here, you know, we're outside the mainstream, and that's great, but we need to do that in all aspects of our lives, or at least be willing to do that. Choose your wealth, choose what makes you feel wealthy, don't allow marketers to do it, and if your friends are telling you that you need to spend more money on alcohol or have a bigger house to be happy, they're probably not the best friends they have. You can also choose your groups. So that is the end of my talk, and goodbye.
Well, thank you. Questions, comments, and that was really thought-provoking. And that was the second time I heard that. And still the only thing I remember is do not move to Denmark. Okay.
Once you exceed $70,000, your happiness kind of tickers off, tapers off. You know? So it's like up to $70,000, you do see some sort of benefit. So they used to say, oh, money doesn't buy happiness, but it seems to actually say, well, actually there's a limit to that, right? But up to $70,000, then you can actually take care of your benefits. I'm wondering if you have any insight into that. Like, do you have any comment on it?
Yeah, so $70,000 is about like a standard deviation of the median household income at $54,000. So, and people are generally feel wealth and happiness by their social status. It's really correlated. So a lot of times that allows you to buy a slightly nicer car than your neighbors. It allows you to have a little less worry about debt. It allows you to live in a slightly nicer house. So a lot of it is actually just a comparative thing against the culture you're around. You're slightly wealthier than average. And then beyond that, you're just excessively, you know, wealthy beyond that. I think a lot of it comes from the status. The other thing is, if you don't know how to manage money properly, and you haven't spent a lot of time doing that, $70,000 gets to the point where you can cover your bases without having that as a mindfulness.
Thank you. It was a great talk. Just a comment. We can go ride bicycles. I try. It doesn't work, it's dangerous. Run it out.
There's a dispute about liking it. I'll let you guys figure it out and then post something in the private group. Because I think it'd be good information for people to have. Yeah. Okay. Over. Oh, did you? Are you saying I? Okay. Gosh. Oh, okay.
So, no, just in relation to liking, just in case anyone's interested. So one, we've talked about the cycle here before. We do have a bike share that's around Houston, and we're continually adding more docs. So I use it, it's like a $90 annual fee, and I take it out from my apartment, I go to Midtown, I cycle downtown, there's a dock outside the building, and I do it, which that's great, and I also advocate biking, but you can't really do it between months or many. You need to have a shower at your place in order to do it. However, you are correct that Houston is not yet really a bike-friendly city. However, they do have an organization here called Bike Houston that is continually advocating for more bike lanes, different routes, all these kind of stuff. So if you want Houston to become a bike city, I would encourage you to get involved with that and start actually talking to the city council, all these kinds of things. Because there are a lot of people that want that, but because it's not part of our culture right now, it's not something that's going to happen naturally.
That's the last question.
Hi,
Ben.
So I saw you
on the
all the movies, they replaced Netflix. If you haven't been to your public library in the last month,
so much.